to produce, and we will propose a number of initiatives in that as well.
Many thanks. And we now move on to the next item of business, as that concludes questions. And we move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14596 in the name of Elizabeth Smith on Scotland's universities. I would invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Liz Smith to speak to and move the motion, please. 14 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And may I straight away move the motion in my name, which makes a very specific demand of the Scottish Government to remove those sections of the Higher Education Bill which would increase the risk of our universities being reclassified as public sector bodies and, by definition, more open to the direction of Scottish Government ministers. Ambitions which the Scottish Cabinet Secretary claims do not exist, but which, because ministers and officials have been unable to produce convincing evidence to the contrary, remain a very serious concern for the entire university sector. Yeah. Indeed, it is abundantly clear from the evidence sessions at both the Education and the Finance Committees of this Parliament that the Scottish Government has been unable to produce the necessary paperwork to defend its cause. Hence the reason why the assumption remains, and it's the reason for this debate this afternoon. Deputy Presiding Officer, we take the Scottish Government at its word. The Higher Education Bill is designed to expand academic freedom, and I have to say it would be very good, Cabinet Secretary, to know exactly how you see that taking place, and to increase the democracy, transparency and accountability within university governance. The Scottish Government claims that the bill is essential to ensure that university governors fully account for the public money they receive, and it also tells us that no one has anything to worry about. The bill is merely building, and I quote, on best practice that is already there. So why then has there been such wide-ranging and fierce criticism, not just within the sector, but amongst business and Civic Scotland? The names which my colleague Annabel Goldie listed in this chamber just before the recess are significant in their number and in their opposition. Partly it's because they remain totally unpersuaded that there is a fundamental failure within the current system of university governance, which is somehow acting to the detriment of higher education. Why, they ask, when there are so many seriously pressing issues in education, such as closing the attainment gap, improving literacy and numeracy, cuts to colleges, to name just but three? Why is the government so focused on a problem for which there appears to be so little evidence? But the greatest anger, and I mean anger, is reserved for two key aspects of the bill, most of which relate to sections 8, 13 and 20, which would change the very nature of our higher education institutions, specifically by increasing ministerial powers and by making universities into public sector bodies. Through the recent exchanges at the Finance and Education Committees, this chamber knows that University Scotland has substantive reasons for being concerned about the prospect of the Office of National Statistics reclassification of universities. These concerns come about after their very careful consideration of the relevant guidance on reclassification issued by ONS, the consideration of the bill alongside existing controls on universities, and consideration of Treasury guidance about the application of the European System of Accounts 2010. Deputy Presiding Officer, that might sound very technical, but it matters. It matters a lot. Because University Scotland rightly make the point that government powers over an institution's constitution are seen within the European System of Accounts as the important indicator of whether an institution should be classified as being within the public sector. And however much the Scottish Government protests, this bill, as it stands just now, expressly gives ministers the power to amend universities' constitutions by altering the composition of their governing bodies, a point that was confirmed by Scottish Government officials at the Education Committee on the 6th of October. It changes universities' constitutions by giving ministers the powers to determine the selection method and term of office of the chair in the governing body. It also expressly gives ministers the power to change universities' constitutions by changing the membership of their internal academic regulatory body. And Treasury guidance on sector classification makes it clear that there is a risk even if ministers do not themselves appoint the members of the governing body. Now, the Scottish Government tells us repeatedly that this is not its intention. It has no desire, if I may, Minister, just finish on this point, I'll let you in. It has no desire, so the Scottish Government says, to expand ministerial control or to insist that universities become public sector bodies.
Dr. Allen.
I thank the member for giving way. Might it not, however, listening to what she said, might it not reasonably be argued that legislation in 1966 and many other acts affecting the constitution of universities in Scotland has changed the constitution of the universities without the least suggestion that this implies ministerial control of them?
Minister, that's completely separate from what is proposed in this bill. And the key issues about this bill, and the ones that I've referred to within the evidence, are very clear that the Scottish Government's reasons for doing this don't stand the test of that evidence that has been presented. That's the issue, Minister. And these concerns that have been raised by University of Scotland back in June, at the time the bill was published, and they've also been raised in a letter that was sent to the Scottish Government on the 13th of August. No reply to that letter was provided until the 16th of October. The only excuse being offered for the delay appeared to be that University of Scotland had asked some very difficult questions. Oh, well, yes, they had. Of course they had. Oh, and the only answer that we can get at the moment, and I quote the officials, we're more than halfway through looking and working on it. Dear. Well, hardly does that inspire any confidence. Now, given that this is becoming the most threatening aspect of the bill, there can be little comfort taken from the Scottish Government's response, and that's a point in which they were criticised by the Finance Committee. When everybody else is arguing that there is a high risk of reclassification, the Scottish Government persists in its claim that we, and I quote again, we deem reclassification to be zero additional risk. But when it's asked for the evidence for this, it can't find it. Most especially as it transpires that it's actually not gone to the bother of taking detailed independent advice in the same way that others.
Brody.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Can you tell me where in the Anderson-Strathern report for the University of Scotland that there is evidence that there will be reclassification of the universities? Where in that record, in that report?
Yeah, I think it's pretty well all through it. Mr. Brody, I heard your questions at the Finance Committee, and I think you have some pretty serious concerns about this as well, the Education Committee as well. So I think it's a bit rich to ask that. If you're prepared, I think I've given away enough, Mr. Mason, just now. If you're prepared to stand up and provide me with the evidence that proves that ministers are not intent on taking control over universities or wanting to reclassify public bodies, I'd be delighted to see it, because as yet we haven't had it. The blunt reality, I think, of the concerns were put to the Finance Committee by Alistair Sim, Professor Anton Muscatelli and Gary Coutts when they set out both the general and the specific risks of ON reclassification. On a general level, ONS reclassification would mean the following. The scope for universities to borrow money would be seriously limited. They could not hold over reserves from one year to the next. There would be a detrimental impact on entrepreneurial activities, business relationships and community engagement. Exactly the reasons why we've seen very senior businessmen like Sir Tom Farmer and Sir Moira Lockhead speak out so strongly against the bill. And there could well be further difficulties faced when attracting philanthropic funding, which last year was worth £53 million. And on a specific level, Anton Muscatelli set out what the numbers would mean for Glasgow University. He told us that his governing body has just approved a plan that will involve an investment of £775 million over the next 10 years, an investment he argues that is of significant positive impact for Glasgow and indeed for Scotland. It includes £29 million for what will be one of four UK quantum technology hubs, a £16 million project aimed at reducing the university's energy running costs by about £2.2 million and its carbon footprint by 20%. The programme, however, has to be financed from operating surpluses in the cash reserves. That will be the order of £145 million by the end of this financial year. And he points out that these projects, which clearly can't be completed in a short-term basis, could not happen in the same way if reclassification occurred. Gary Coutts, same committee, told us that the issues would be just the same for Highlands and Islands University, a unique and diverse institution which has done so much in recent years to provide many new and exciting opportunities for Scotland. It's an institution which has direct experience of what reclassification has meant for colleges in terms of not being able to retain reserves from one year to the next. And Mr. Coutts made the point that the UHI's efforts to develop new student premises, new courses and new community partnerships might all seriously be undermined if universities became public sector bodies. Now, multiply the financial effects on Glasgow University and Highlands and Islands, multiply that for the whole sector, and the total is close to £1 billion. Now, that is surely something that the SNP could not possibly have on their political conscience. And that is why I repeat the call for the Scottish Government today to commit to removing those sections of the bill which have so clearly alarmed so many in the sector, and which, if they were allowed to proceed, would do untold damage to the viability of that sector. Deputy Presiding Officer, just a few weeks ago, the Higher Education International Rankings revealed that 5 Scottish universities are currently in the top 200, and that 3 of them are in the top 100 in the world. And as the Cabinet Secretary herself said shortly before recess, that is a remarkable achievement by any standard. Indeed, I don't think it really matters which academic, economic, social, cultural measurement is chosen. Scottish universities are held in the highest esteem throughout the world. Yeah. That is precisely because they have a long-standing and proud tradition of attracting the very best students and staff and of maintaining their international competitiveness. Yes, I would.
The member mentioned students, but the National Union of Students say there is a lack of genuine democratic culture in governing bodies, a lack of transparency and accountability over how decisions are made and who makes them. Is that not a problem that needs to be addressed?
I have to say that I have some comments here from students who take completely the opposite view in respect of that. I have somebody who is president of the EIS in the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland who is arguing... Well, you may laugh, but that is one of our best institutions. It's one of our most diverse. It's one that has the highest international reputation, and you laugh it off as though it doesn't matter. That is pathetic. But let's get back to the absolute basics of this. That reputation that our universities have, including those reputations held by the Royal Conservatoire, they are about the diversity, they are about the precious autonomy that they have, and they are about the flexibility with which they are able to take part in what is a highly competitive market in education. If there is one thing about this bill that really has a significant problem, it is the lack of the evidence that has been put forward by the Scottish Government to go with it. It doesn't matter how many times Scottish Government officials are asked. It doesn't matter how many times we ask for the backup evidence to support everything that they have said. It is simply not there. That is the crucial problem. And if the Cabinet Secretary is willing to provide some of that reassurance, then perhaps we'll be able to take a different view. But this has been going on since the bill was published in June.
Absolutely.
Constantly going on since it was published in June. And to date, we simply don't have these answers. I think it is absolutely incumbent upon the Scottish Government to make a move on this. Scottish universities are the jewel in the crown of so many aspects of Scottish life. Are we really saying that we want to undo that by a piece of unnecessary, unevidenced, and completely unacceptable legislation which is going to do nothing to enhance the reputations and everything to damage it? Deputy Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary has some serious answers to give about this bill, and I invite her today not only to remove those very dangerous parts of that, but to provide us with the evidence that to date has been so sadly missing.
Many thanks. And I now call on Angela Constance to speak to and move Amendment 14596.2. Cabinet Secretary, you have 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that the Conservatives have again chosen to discuss Scotland's universities. It gives us all another opportunity to celebrate Scotland's higher education sector and their success. And today's debate also provides an opportunity to promote the Higher Education Governance Bill, and in doing so to describe in clear and rational terms how it will help to enhance the reputation of our excellent institutions. This bill will ensure that every member of the campus community, including students, staff and unions, has an equal say on how our institutions are led towards future success, because our institutions are a success. And under this government, Scottish higher education continues to thrive. and Scotland's students and researchers continue to benefit. And this year, the Scottish Government is investing over £1 billion in our higher education institutions. In a period of UK government-imposed austerity, we have invested at this level every year since 2012-13. And as Liz Smith rightly mentioned, and it's worth repeating, new rankings published on the 30th of September show that Scotland has five universities in the top 200 of the Times Higher Education World University Rankings for 2015-16, and that's one more than last year. And our universities also have a world-class reputation for research, with 77% of the research assessed as world-leading or internationally excellent in the 2014 Research Excellence Framework exercise. Presiding Officer, turning now to the Higher Education Governance Bill, essentially it aims to strengthen governance in our institutions, making them more modern, transparent and inclusive. The Bill's content has been informed by the evidence gathered and recommendations set out in the review of the higher education governance led by Professor Vaughan Prinzinski, published in 2012. Presiding Officer, this Government has listened carefully to the views expressed by all stakeholders and partners on the provisions in the Bill and is familiar with them and respectful of the arguments advanced. And I'll give way briefly to Mr Brown.
I'm grateful to her for giving me. Can she confirm, though, that the clauses which caused the most concern, namely 8, 13 and 20, were not part of that review and were not part of the government consultation on the bill?
I'm certainly aware that there are four clauses in the bill that some stakeholders have genuinely held beliefs about. Section 1, and as Mr Brown mentions, clauses 8, 13 and 20. The Section 1... We'll get to your answer if you do me the courtesy of listening, Mr Brown. Section 1 is purely creating a space to allow for that further dialogue and to create an opportunity for co-design across the sector about the process of how chairs can be nominated and elected. And it is the government's intention that by stage 2 that there will be stage 2 amendments to replace Section 1. With regards to sections 8, 13 and 20, those are quite simply about future-proofing a bill that has very discrete purposes. But where I can give an assurance to Mr Brown, because we view all commentators as critical friends, where there is scope to alleviate concerns that I don't accept, but nonetheless, where there is scope to refine and improve draftment and alleviate concerns and make improvements, we will indeed take the opportunity to improve those aspects of the bill. Let me make some progress, and I may come back to Ms Smith. Because, Presiding Officer, I want to make four very clear statements aimed at addressing the points made by some stakeholders and, of course, by the Conservatives in their opening address. Firstly, the Scottish Government does not seek to advance ministerial control of our higher education institutions, either by this Government or any future Government. Scottish universities are autonomous bodies and will remain so, and we are crystal clear on that point. Further, we are not of the view that the content of this Bill adds to any risk of reclassification of Scottish higher education institutions as public sector bodies by the Office for National Statistics. And I have written to the Finance Committee to that effect and note that committee's recommendation that all analysis conducted by the Scottish Government on this matter be shared prior to the Stage 1 debate to be held early in 2016. And next, reclassification, and I have to stress this, Presiding Officer, reclassification is an outcome that the Scottish Government would never want to realise. And finally, I welcome the comments of the Finance Committee on its recent report on the financial memorandum to the Bill that the written evidence submitted to the Education and Culture Committee by the Office of Scottish Charity Regulator addresses satisfactorily the points made by some stakeholders that the Bill's provisions might jeopardise the charitable status of our higher education institutions. Briefly.
Ms. Smith.
Thank you for what you have just said, but I'm afraid I don't accept that there's any clarity there whatsoever. On the 6th of October, one of your Scottish Government officials was asked by myself if there would be any alteration to constitutions of universities. And after a long wrangle, it transpired that, well, actually, yes, there would be some changes to that. And that, by definition, Cabinet Secretary, means that the government is taking some ministerial control.
Absolutely.
And the follow-on from that is that that has an implication for the reclassification. That is the concern. Your officials are not in tune with what you were saying.
The bottom line, Ms. Smith, is that this bill does not give me any more powers as a minister. And if we need to refine aspects of the bill to clarify that, we will indeed. We haven't even reached, we've not reached stage two yet, which is a very important part of the parliamentary process, because we gave a commitment. We gave a commitment to serious discussion with our stakeholders. And regarding the very specific point about altering constitutions of higher education institutions and the point she makes about ONS, in evidence to the Education Committee, OSCAR examined in detail whether or not the Bill's impact on the constitutions of the ancients would revisit in the charitable status, result in charitable status being jeopardised, and they concluded that that is not the case. And during FMQs prior to recess, Ruth Davidson said that the bill could jeopardise charitable status, and I would hope that Chamber and indeed Conservatives would accept that that is not the case. I need to make some progress, Presiding Officer, and I want to focus on the overarching aim of this bill. This government is committed to creating a fairer, more inclusive Scotland, one which better reflects our nation's diversity and which everyone gets to have their say. And by enabling a more transparent and open governance in our universities, we can ensure that every voice in the campus community is heard and involved in taking decisions. And that's why we've made sure that the bill contains provisions to allow staff and students, including trade unions, a guaranteed seat at the table on university governing bodies. And Labour may wish to note that this bill has significant support from students, NUS and Scotland, and many individual academics in the UCU and EIS fell. And my office is full of hundreds of these postcards from academics the length and breadth of Scotland. And as we begin to plan for stage two of the parliamentary process, we will, as I said earlier, Presiding Officer, continue to examine all of the constructive ideas and suggestions put to us and the contributions of the relevant committees. And as I say, Section 1 of the Bill, which deals with elected chairs of governing bodies, was introduced as a power for ministers to make regulations in order to provide time for a substantive dialogue to be conducted with all stakeholders, including rectors, on the model for the appointment of elected chairs in Scottish higher education institutions. And that dialogue, you know, has begun, and that dialogue will continue in advance of Stage 2. And I am aware that this outcome is favoured by Professor von Pranczynski, as recorded in his submission of written evidence to the Education and Culture Committee. And finally, Presiding Officer, I want to be very clear that the bill will not abolish or diminish the role of rectors in our ancient universities. The role of rector is part of a democratic tradition in five of our universities that is also in keeping with the spirit of democratic renewal in forming this bill. And in talking to all stakeholders about how a model for elected chairs in our institutions might work, we are committed to ensuring that the role of rectors continues. Presiding Officer, we are looking closely at all parts of the bill that provide ministers with the ability to frame secondary legislation. Those elements of the bill which are, as I said earlier, largely intended to future-proof the legislation. And let me just reiterate, this bill is intended to be a discreet, targeted, focused piece of legislation, and as such, the views and suggestions made by stakeholders on the necessity of including all relevant sections in their current form is being examined very thoroughly
close,
indeed.
Please.
And I move the amendment in my name.
Thanks. Now call on Ian Gray to speak to and move Amendment 14596.1. Mr Gray, you have 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise to move the amendment in my name. There is no doubt the Cabinet Secretary is right about the importance of the university sector to Scotland. We do have more world-class universities per head than any other country in the world. They deliver an economic impact of over £11 billion to the economy and support 144,000 jobs. Their history is long and proud and to be cherished. From the old chestnut of Scottish exceptionalism, that in the 16th century we had as many universities in Aberdeen alone as there were in the whole of England, to the current day when our universities win much more than their fair share of UK research funding, and when we publish more peer-reviewed research papers per head of population than any other country bar two. Yet, for 8 years, this government's vision of universities has never really stretched much beyond free tuition. Way back in 2002, when I was the minister responsible for the university sector, tuition fees had already been abolished in Scotland, and the debate was about the role of those universities in creating the jobs and industries of the future. Debates about how better to support that astonishing research base, how to commercialise new intellectual property into businesses and jobs, new initiatives like SMART, SPUR, proof of concept funding, new models like the co-investment funds, the intermediary technology institutes. Indeed, every week saw us debate groundbreaking and imaginative ideas to build on the university sector of which we are so proud. Not so much now. This government has decreed that we will debate and redebate tuition fees until the rocks melt in the sun, even although it was a debate already won 14 years ago. So, it should be welcome when finally, after 8 years, they turn their mind to something else about universities. But what a mess they are making of it. Let me be clear. We support the idea of chairs of court elected by the whole university community. We support trade union representation on those courts. We support transparency of governance and indeed remuneration. There is work still to be done on the format of elections. There is work to be done on finding a way to avoid losing the historic post or title of rector for those institutions for whom it is part of their tradition. We believe that there are compromises and even a consensus to be reached on these issues amongst stakeholders. But that is all being undermined by the drafting of the bill, which would allow ministers to exercise undefined powers for an unknown purpose through regulation. It is these powers and that lack of definition which has raised concerns, firstly about the degree of control ministers seek, and consequently the heightened risk it involves of ONS reclassification, which would jeopardise the finances of the universities. And frankly, the Scottish Government need to fix this, and soon. It is not fixed through bland assertions from the minister that they will not overreach their powers of control. It is not enough for ministers not to have the intent to interfere. The legislation needs to be clear that they do not have the power to interfere.
Angela Constance.
I wonder if Mr Gray would accept that there are a variety of voices in this debate, and I wonder if he would accept the views of Unison Scotland, who in evidence to the Education Committee concluded that there seems therefore to be no risk of reclassification following the implementation of this bill. Is he not concerned that by voting with the Tories today that he is participating in a bit of a smokescreen for those who at the end of the day just don't want trade unionists on boards or indeed elected chairs?
Presiding Officer, I will take no lectures from Ms Constance on support for trade unions. I have been a trade unionist all my adult life and I will continue to do exactly that. The smokescreen here is the smokescreen of why ministers feel it is necessary to give themselves regulatory powers they do not need in order to achieve those ends on which I agree with her. We have been here before. Colleges were promised the government would find a solution to their reclassification. No solution has ever emerged, and colleges are paying the price in finance, fiscal problems right now. We've been here with police reorganisation. The government were warned again and again that their model would make Police Scotland vulnerable to VAT. Solutions were suggested, they were ignored, and now the government are running round Westminster crying foul grievance, as if, I suggest, that was what they were looking for all along. The truth is that the Finance Committee have already examined government officials' and others' assurances on the ONS point, and they have not found their performance and the evidence reassuring in any way. The Cabinet Secretary, and this is what the Cabinet Secretary should think about, is how she has managed to get herself into the completely unnecessary position of uniting those of us who support much of the bill and those who oppose, I suspect, all of the bill in our condemnation, not of those purposes, but of her handling of this legislation.
Must draw to a close, please.
If she's wrong about the financial consequences for this sector, so critical to our future, then the results will be disastrous. She must produce incontrovertible evidence or tell us exactly how she intends to amend the bill to remove the risk. When it comes to universities, the Cabinet Secretary has had one job to do. It's time she got a grip of it.
Many thanks. And we now move to open debate, 6-minute speeches. I call on George Adam to be followed by Cara Hilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I always welcome a debate in Scottish education and enjoy listening to colleagues' views on the challenges that we face ahead. However, currently we have not completed stage one on the Education and Culture Committee of the Higher Education Governance Bill. I will, of course, thoroughly examine all the written evidence and listen to any constructive suggestions. So at the moment, Presiding Officer, this all seems a bit premature. But with that caveat in mind, I make the following comments. The Scottish – no, I've got far too much to go through there, Ms Smith. The Scottish Government has made it clear that the universities are and will remain autonomous bodies. Why would anyone want to take away that which is seen as fundamental to our universities' worldwide success? The aim of the Higher Education Governance Bill is to modernise, strengthen governance, ensuring that the principles of democracy and accountability are an integral part of the higher education sector. Ferdinand von Brudzinski, Principal and Vice-Chancellor of Robert Gordon University and Chair of the Scottish Government's Review of Higher Education Governance, said earlier this year, universities are autonomous bodies and should be, but their autonomy should not shield them from the legitimate expectations that they engage with staff, students and external partners, or that they need to behave in an accountable manner. I've still got quite a lot to go through as well. He added, none of this is about government control. None of our recommendations, and indeed none of the proposed elements of the government's planned legislation, would give any power to ministers to interfere in the running of institutions. The 2012 review is the foundation of the bill. With regards to any potential ONS reclassification of universities, I would like to say that this has been central to the Scottish Government's consideration throughout the development of the bill. While providing evidence to the Scottish Parliament's Finance Committee, Scottish Government officials stated the following. We deem reclassification to be a low risk. However, if as a result of wider ONS review of universities there were any risk of reclassifications, ministers made it clear that that is not a policy goal. We would take that what measures were required to ensure the universities were not reclassified. However, if as a result of wider ONS review of universities. So the government has said there is no intention that this bill would lead to reclassification. Unionist in Scotland helpfully pointed out that the Education Committee in written evidence, universities have a range of income sources and the proposed bill will not impact on the balance of funding. The difference in borrowing powers was also said to be significant. Colleges, unlike universities, require government permission to borrow. There seems, therefore, no risk of reclassification following the implementation of the bill. but it is my belief that the talk of ONS reclassification is taking us away from the more fundamental point of this debate. This is about ensuring that our higher education institutions have open, transparent and modern governance. Surely that is a good thing, Presiding Officer. I would argue that involving staff and students in the governance of their institutions, as was the view of the von Prondonsky Review, would create an extremely positive and dynamic structure of culture of governance. As Mary Senior, UCU Scotland, said at the Education Culture Committee roundtable on the 6th of October, no one is questioning the Scottish universities are good. They are good. What we are saying is that they could be much better if staff, student and trade unions were fully involved in how they operate. It is my opinion that this creates a form of collective responsibility that means that decisions can be made by all representatives of the university community. I cannot see any negatives with this, and that is why I support the elected chair of court or Senate as a way forward. It also creates an openness that is not currently there. And NUS Scotland mentioned this in their briefing for the debate. They are concerned that there is a need for greater democratic culture of governing bodies. NUS Scotland states that while many student associations are able to take part in the university court meetings, many student representatives feel that these meetings act merely as a rubber stamp exercise to validate decisions that have already been taken by the principal or at committee level. They believe that there is a need for greater transparency over decisions. In addition to a lack of participation in democratic culture on governing bodies, there is a distinct lack of transparency, they state, over governance decisions. They provided an example of this being investment discussions, decisions of universities and increasing principals' pay packages of the institutions. Let's look at this further, Presiding Officer. Let's take the University of Edinburgh, although they're not alone in this with salaries. In 2005, 190 people had a salary between £70,000 and £189,000. In 2014, 440 people had a salary between £70,000 and £319,000, with the top salary being anywhere between £340,000 and £349,000. At this stage, I don't know how much the top salary is because it isn't actually clear from the information you can get. That doesn't mean that there isn't an answer to that question. It means that surely if we had the democracy within the universities, we'd have an opportunity to be able to see what is actually available there. So, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government provides £1 billion of public money in our higher education institutions. They do this because the educational future of our young people is important to us all. They do it because our world-leading universities give so much back to our nation. But we cannot stand back and admire this great buck and not move our universities on. It's time to make sure that we equip them for the 21st century.
Thanks so much. Now call on Cara Hilton to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have the chance to speak in today's debate on Scotland's universities and in support of Scottish Labour's amendment. Scottish Labour recognises the outstanding contribution that Scotland's universities make to the academic, economic, social and cultural life of Scotland. We welcome their continued success in attracting high-quality students and staff from all around the world and in producing groundbreaking research. And we value the vital role that our universities play in Scotland's economy, employing more than 42,000 people and supporting more than 144,000 jobs. However, there's no doubt that higher education institutions could benefit from being more open and accountable. The Higher Education Governance Bill provides real scope for change, and that's why Scottish Labour supports the principles of this bill. But it's absolutely crucial that, when we're looking at reform and how our universities run, we ensure careful and thorough scrutiny. The bill in particular presents real opportunities to address current shortfalls in university governance, highlighted by the member, which I've forgotten his name. And in particular, we support the measures to ensure that staff, students and trade unions are represented in the decision-making structures, that they have a real voice and a real say in the future of the universities that they learn, teach and work in. It's only right that public institutions that receive many millions of pounds from the taxpayer are run in a way that's open, democratic and transparent. Right now, that doesn't always happen, and the feedback that I've received too from students' associations is often they feel that they don't have a real say. There is the sense that decisions that they're involved in are simply a rubber stamp exercise rather than open debate and genuine scrutiny. NUS point out in their debate the briefing for today's debate that the lack of transparency has affected how two key issues have been handled recently, the investment decisions of universities and the increasing principals' pay packages in our higher education institutions. And I know this isn't strictly covered in today's motion, but I really do think this is an important issue that should be highlighted. I have absolutely no doubt that government boards would make better decisions if they better reflected the students and the staff body and if trade unions were involved in that process. Research by NUS Scotland found that there are 88 individuals at Scottish universities who earn more than the First Minister. That's £140,000 a year. And I don't think it can be right that university principals on three-figure salaries take large pay increases while their staff are told to accept a 1% pay increase, which is effectively a pay cut. So I support the call being made by NUS to extend the transparency and the accountability in the government's bill, but to governing body subcommittees, particularly those dealing with senior staff pay. Given that hundreds of millions of pounds of public money goes quite rightly to support our universities, I think that it's only right that we see more public scrutiny over the excess wages that many in the top of our universities receive, while staff at the lower end of the scale struggle to get by. And I welcome some action from the government on that issue. Turning to our amendment this afternoon, while Scottish Labour is genuinely supportive of the Higher Education Governance Bill, we are also very conscious of the need to ensure that reform does not undermine the academic autonomy of the university sector or its financial position. I'm sure I'm not the only member who's received many emails on this issue from concerned constituents, raising in particular worries about the implications for academic freedom and university finances. Last month, Glasgow University Rector Edward Snowden described the government's bill as a real threat to the financial and academic independence of the university system in Scotland, and a real concerns about how the plans might dilute the voice of students in our ancient universities, and that perhaps a one-size-fits-all approach isn't quite right. There's been concern too about the future of the role of the rector in our ancient universities, and Labour's amendment calls for protection of this position. I know that Angela Constance has offered reassurance on this issue, and that is very welcome. Our amendment today also highlights the very real risk that the Higher Education Governance Bill could lead to a change in the ONS classification of universities, and Ian Gray has already outlined our serious concerns here. There are real concerns in the university sector that the proposals could lead to unintended consequences, which will ultimately undermine the university sector and cause difficulties in ensuring its future charitable status. In this respect, the Royal Society of Edinburgh have warned that the bill as it stands represents a level of government intervention that's entirely inappropriate for an autonomous sector, potentially damaging the university sector in terms both of its global academic standing, its entrepreneurial activity and the contribution to the Scottish economy. And in their briefing for today's debate, University Scotland highlights serious concerns that sections 8, 13 and 20 of the bill would, and I quote from their briefing, take an unprecedented step over the line of university autonomy. University Scotland and others believe that the increased potential for ministerial control puts Scottish higher education at heightened and significant risk of reclassification as public bodies by the Office of National Statistics. And obviously, this could have potentially devastating effects. I appreciate that the Cabinet Secretary has said this is not the case, but I really do think that these concerns can't be swept under the carpet. Ian Gray highlighted the, Ian Gray highlighted the example of the fire and police service in terms of VAT, and that's a prime example of the unintended consequences that can come back to bite later on. So that's why Scottish Labour's amendment today calls for the Scottish Government to seek urgent legal and technical advice on the matter and to publish this analysis in full. And that's why we also want to see a commitment to remove all clauses from the bill that could increase the risk of ONS classification. This is absolutely vital to protect the independence of our universities and their financial position. Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope that the Scottish Government will listen to the very real concerns being expressed about this bill. I hope too that we'll see progress on the issues not currently included, such as principals' pay. And the future of the Scottish economy depends on a vibrant, independent and world-leading university sector. And I hope that we can all work together to ensure the best possible outcome here for staff, students and for our universities.
Many thanks. I call on Liam MacArthur to be followed by John Mason. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking Liz Smith for allowing this debate to take place? Of course, the Education Committee is currently undertaking its stage one scrutiny of the HE Governance Bill, and we'll return to this subject, I think, on a number of occasions in the coming months. However, given the level of concerns that exist about the potential this thin bill, as our committee convener, I think, accurately described it, could have on our world-class university sector, the more times we get to kick the tyres, the better. The 300 and more submissions received by the committee tells its own story, highlighting the strength of feeling and the, what is at stake. At our recent round table, there was vigorous debate and often profound disagreement. Where all agreed, of course, was on the quality of our universities, with five of our institutions in the top 200 worldwide and three in the top 100. No one disputes this is an area where Scotland excels, punching well above its weight. While a source of pride, this is certainly not a state of affairs that can or should be taken for granted. And again, we heard unanimity around the need for continued improvement, innovation, and the constant state of change. But we must be clear what any change will achieve, how it will deliver improvement, something better than what we already have, and certainly how it will avoid diminishing the value of our universities to students, staff, and the wider community that derives so much from their success. In that respect, as I have done before, I can't help arising at the conclusion that much of what the government is seeking to do here looks like solutions casting around desperately for a problem to solve. I recognise that Angela Constance is dealing here with an inheritance from her predecessor who pursued this agenda with some zeal. I acknowledge too that she's hinted again today at a willingness to ditch some of the most damaging elements, and I hope she will have the courage to do just that. But fundamentally, the regulatory powers ministers are looking to take through this bill present a real and present threat to our universities. The fact that many remain unclear and subject to secondary legislation only makes matters worse. For all the minister offers reassurance about how she would use these powers, the fact remains, as Ian Gray says, that it is the scope of the bill that matters, not the intentions of any one minister. Universities Scotland have been unambiguous in the threat posed. Their legal advice shows that the cumulative provisions of this bill, notably parts 8, 13 and 20, heighten the risk of ONS reclassification of higher education institutions. Anderson Strathairn state, if ONS carried out an assessment in the near future, the challenges posed to HEIs by such an exercise should appear at the level of significant risk on their risk registers. It could not be clearer. For the Minister to assert in her amendment that, quote, the Bill's provisions do not increase that risk is frankly not credible, nor is it right for this Parliament to be asked to support such a baseless assertion this afternoon. Mr Swinney may have his own reservations given the threat of an additional £530 million being added to government borrowing. Very briefly.
John Mason.
Thank you. I don't know what evidence or base he would like. He says it's a baseless claim, but is there somebody he would like to give a comment on that? Because the ONS won't.
Liam McCarthy.
Well, I think I'm not sure whether John Mason, maybe in his forthcoming remarks, will explain his view on the Strathairn legal advice that the committee and the Parliament has been privy to. But we haven't seen anything of equivalence from the Scottish Government in their assertions. And the consequences of reclassification are serious. They've been laid out in stark terms to the Education and Finance Committees. A loss of incentive to earn around £1 billion of entrepreneurial income. Restrictions on borrowing worth around £370 million, the inability to create surpluses and invest in improved facilities, putting capital programmes at risk. Hardly, I would argue, a price worth risking, far less paying. As we have heard at the round table session, though, it is a risk that is already being felt in the reputational damage done by the perception of increased ministerial interference in our universities. Deputy Presiding Officer, all the evidence shows that the best performing universities worldwide are those exercising the highest level of responsible autonomy. They should be accountable, transparent, and reflect the diversity of the communities they serve. How this is best achieved, however, should not be second-guessed by ministers using the blunt instrument of legislation, particularly given the highly diverse nature of this sector. And at no stage have ministers or their officials been able to point to the international comparators to which we should be aspiring. I have no difficulty accepting that our universities, excellent though they are, could be better. However, I would like some reassurance that, in terms of governance, the standard to which they're being asked to adhere has demonstrated itself somewhere, anywhere else, to deliver better results and wider benefits. On union and student representation on governing bodies, I'm not necessarily convinced this needs writing into law. Staff and student representation is an essential but existing feature of university governance. That said, I can live with these provisions if gaps need to be filled. On elected chairs, I agree with Stuart Maxwell that it's hard to see how these proposals can be squared with the Minister's commitment not to diminish the role of rectors. And on academic freedom, there is no evidence that this is currently curtailed. Ministers insist, you'll be able to deal with that in your own intervention, Stuart. Ministers insist it is a minor change but offer no explanation of the problems it is aimed at addressing. Presiding Officer, this is a thin bill that has the potential to do damage. Its potential to do damage should not be underestimated. Legislation is not always the answer. Some might argue it is rarely the answer. Certainly the perils of using such a blunt instrument to manage such a diverse sector are obvious. The SNP must accept that ministers do not always know best, that one size does not fit all, and that the temptation always to control should be resisted. In that context, Scottish Liberal Democrats will be supporting the motion and Ian Gray's amendment later this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call John Mason to be followed by Annabel Goldie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We spent a fair bit of time at the Finance Committee on 16 September considering the financial memorandum for the Higher Education Governance Bill, so my comments today largely stem from evidence we heard then. Would you mind? Sorry. The day of the committee, there had been a letter in the Herald from Dr. Ian Banks, President of the University and College Union in Glasgow, who refers to the difficulty faced by staff and students wishing to influence a governance system that is too often focused on business rather than education or research. That's a quote out of his letter. I did ask the witnesses if the ONS, Oscar and financial concerns were really just a smokescreen the universities were using to avoid democracy and transparency. Professor Anton Muscatelli assured us that this was not the case, but I still remain uncertain what the university's real agenda is. The unions are strongly supportive of the proposed governance changes, and they are intelligent people who want the universities to thrive. So there is at least some disconnect here between management and staff. ONS reclassification would clearly be a major concern to all of us, and we spent a considerable amount of time at committee on this point, as George Adam has referred to. Mr. Gray.
Ian Gray.
I think there's some merit to the point Mr. Mason makes, but surely the biggest disconnect here is the disconnect between the Cabinet Secretary's assertion that government ministers have no desire to take more control and clauses in the bill which would allow them to do just that. If they don't want to take control, isn't the easiest way to deal with this to remove those powers from the bill?
John Mason.
Well, I mean, I'm not in the Education Committee, I'm looking at this mainly from a financial point of view, but from my angle, there's a big difference between changing the structure of how our board comes about from actually putting people on the board. Now, maybe there's some tweaking can be done as the bill works its way through. But the principle, I mean, we have got involved, if we could, we'd get involved in how companies choose their boards. We get involved in how loads of charities, they have to conform to lots of rules, and the public sector. So it's not unusual for government to get involved in outside organisations. To go back to reclassification, it was made clear to us by the bill team that if a reclassification is triggered, it does not come into immediate effect. The colleges in England and Wales were then given a period of time in which to review their control mechanisms and make changes that would keep them outside the boundary. So let me just finish this point. I found that quote interesting, as we are not faced with some huge gamble here, and if we lose everything. Rather, there is an issue which may or may not occur, and if it does occur, we will have the chance to fix it before it becomes a reality. Ms. Smith.
Liz Smith.
For giving way, and just on the question of this gamble, Mr. Mason, you were questioning Mr. Sim on this committee that you refer to, and you asked him about the degree of risk, and Mr. Sim said, I find it easier to put the risk in terms of red, amber and green. You went on to ask him what that was, and he said, I put the risk at the top of the red.
John Mason.
He also said that the current risk was at least amber. So what he was saying was there is a considerable there is a considerable...
Order, please. Can we hear
what
you
were saying is there is a considerable current risk. Now, the debate is, does this bill affect that risk? Does it take it up the scale? Clearly, the universities are saying it does. Clearly, the bill team and the government are saying it doesn't. That can be looked at in more detail, but it's certainly not a given that the risk is increased by this bill. Now, the motion suggests that the Scottish Government should seek urgent, quote, seek urgent external legal and technical advice on reclassification. Now, this was another topic we considered at the Finance Committee, and the answers were, first, that the bill team was not aware of experts in this field who were likely to know more than the Scottish Government. And in fact, it was suggested that even the ONS, quote, considers the Scottish Government to be a leading expert on reclassification. Now, I do not know if Liz Smith has a particular expert in mind when she wrote the motion, but I'm sure we'd like to know who it is, and neither Labour nor the Lib Dems have been able to suggest that either. Secondly, it was suggested that we ask ONS themselves about the risk, but we understand they do not give advice in advance. In addition, it strikes me that writing to ONS highlighting the risk might actually damage our case more than help it. Now, another topic which we considered at the Finance Committee was charitable status and what Oscar's opinion might be. I'll not quote that from that. We've had that already. But basically, Oscar's saying there is no risk as far as they're concerned. University of Scotland confirmed that they would take Oscar's view at face value. At that point, it does not appear to be in the... Well, it's not in the Conservative motion at all. And I assume, therefore, that there is fairly widespread agreement that charitable status is not likely to be at risk. However, there is for me the question as to whether the universities have been crying wolf on charitable status, which has now been dismissed, and if they were crying wolf on that issue, are they crying wolf on a number of other issues as well? I mean, Liz Smith says she wants written evidence against something that we don't even know if it exists. If somebody asked me, did I rob a bank last night, I would say no. Have I got written evidence to prove it? No, I do not. I think we are all agreed we have a university sector to be proud of, but the question is, can it be improved? And in particular, can its governance be improved? Or is it like some highly delicate flower that if we even touched it, would collapse and die? I thought the NUS briefing for the debate was particularly helpful when it gave a reason for needing more transparency and accountability, namely that we might all know, quote, how decisions are made and who makes them. I think many of us had thought that this was a given in 2015 for almost all parts of the third and public sector. Yet the universities stick out as something of a sore thumb in resisting movement in that direction. Presiding Officer, I believe our universities are robust. They are living organisms which can and should adapt to the 21st century. I think we may have been timid in the past for fear of upsetting organisations which have a lot of money and have a lot of friends in high places. But just as governance in private business and public sector and other parts of the third sector has moved on over the years, so I believe our universities need to remember they are servants of the public and the public expects them to be open and transparent in their governance arrangements. Thank you.
Many thanks. Before we move on, can I advise the Chamber I allowed Mr Mason some time back for the intervention that he took. However, we are now running out of time, so I'd ask members to keep to their 6 minutes, please. Annabel Goldie to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Deputy Presiding Officer, can I refer to a relevant interest? I am a graduate and honorary fellow of the University of Strathclyde, and I served in the court of the university for a number of years. This debate sees this Parliament being used for proper purpose. If governance cannot be called to account for and challenged by an opposition party, then a Parliament is wanting. And I'm very pleased that my party has secured this debate on these highly controversial proposals to change university governance. What no one can level against my party in citing our objection to these proposals is a charge of political opportunism or political dogma or obsession with ideology, just being difficult with the SNP for the sake of it. And that is because the level of opposition to this university governance bill is massive, and most of it is out with the realm of political parties. I see I have affected the Cabinet Secretary deeply, but I hope she will return. Now, my party, Deputy Presiding Officer, is the conduit for conveying that huge anxiety and unease to this Parliament. So let me examine the Scottish Government's premise for change. The first test to be applied is, what is wrong that the Scottish Government thinks needs fixing? The evidence is sparse. By general assent, as other contributors have said, our universities are doing a very good job. Some are excelling by international standards. That points to good governance, not bad. So where is the problem? And this is the irony. I think the problem is not with our universities at all, but rather with the Scottish Government. Because the genesis for these proposals seems to be that when universities rightly took responsibility for their futures, requiring to focus on their strengths, that, let me continue for the moment, their core fields of excellence and plan accordingly, some members of staff and some trade unions were hostile to that, and they took that view because there were redundancies. Now, let me be clear. It is right that staff members and their unions should examine any proposals involving loss of jobs. It is right they should ensure that the interests of their members are represented, and they should assist in discussions with the individual universities to scrutinise such proposals. And it is right these concerns should be within the knowledge of the court. What is not right, indeed what is patently wrong, is to attempt to argue that universities are public bodies and as such should not be permitted to take such governance decisions and should have their governance regulated. And let me deal with that misconception and articulate some general principles. Just because a public body receives a part of its funding from the public purse does not make it a public, or just because a body receives a part of its funding from the public purse does not make it a public body. Because if that were the case, Deputy Presiding Officer, private healthcare providers, most Scottish pharmacies, security companies delivering services for the Scottish Government justice system and other contractors deriving significant revenues from the Scottish Government would be public bodies. And such a suggestion is ridiculous. They are not, nor are the autonomous institutions which are our universities. Indeed, if the Scottish Government argument were correct, there are hundreds of thousands of organisations the length and breadth of Scotland receiving regular sums of public money who, by the Scottish Government's own logic, should now be the subject of governance intervention because they are public bodies. Well, even, of course, by the Scottish Government standards, that would be a ludicrous proposition. Universities are, of course, autonomous and independently constituted. They are not public bodies, and the Scottish Government should not try to make them so. But for the sake of hypothesis, let's assume that the government analysis is correct and examine what these sparsely proposals mean in practice. They mean a shift in focus from the primary collective responsibility of a university board of governance for the whole institution to an elected chairman who then is accountable to an electorate and who has to reconcile that obligation with a parallel duty to other court members and to the institution as a whole. That creates divided loyalties, an irreconcilable conflict of interest. It also creates weak leadership and governance confusion. And for the older institutions which have elected rectors, which I understand the Scottish Government has confirmed will remain, there is an added conflict as to who is accountable to whom and whose view prevails if there is a difference of opinion between the rector and the elected chairman. Presiding Officer, it is not surprising that you will not find such a model of governance anywhere. It is so inherently flawed, it is unworkable. And let me seek to educate the Cabinet Secretary. In 2000, the Scottish Qualifications Authority, and it is a public body, ran up against problems with delayed exam results, and its governance was investigated by the Enterprise and Lifelong Learning Committee of this Parliament. The convener was Alex Neil, and his SNP colleague was Fergus Ewing. And I quote from the committee report. And when talking about weaknesses in governance and a board member's role, the report said this: there does appear from their evidence to be confusion in the minds of some board members about their role on the Board of Management. It is clear from the government guidance that board members are appointed as individuals to bring their personal expertise and experience to the boardroom table. They are not appointed as representatives of other organisations. At least one board member appeared to take the latter view. This is not a position which the committee finds tenable. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this bill, in relation to university governance, proceeds on one misconception after another. Yes, develop with the universities a good code of practice for governance. Yes, encourage universities to engage in good practice. But I say to the Scottish Government, do not get mixed up in telling universities what to do. They are already running themselves more successfully than any government can ever achieve. And I say to the Cabinet Secretary, stop digging. Heed what this Parliament's committee found out 15 years ago and what most of Scotland is now telling her, and review this misconceived, flawed and inept proposal.
Many thanks. I now call Gordon MacDonald to be followed by John Pentland.
Thanks very much, Convener. Presiding Officer. I'm fortunate in my constituency of Edinburgh Pentlands. Not only do I have two excellent universities in Heriot Watt and Napier, but my two sons are graduates from those institutions. The two universities in my constituency and the other 17 institutions across Scotland employ over 42,000 staff and educate over 215,000 students. It's therefore important that their voice is heard in this debate, as they overwhelmingly are the university community. Universities have raised concerns about ONS reclassification due to the Higher Education Governance Bill and what effect it could have on their autonomy and revenue. But what are the views of staff and students? After all, they too would be affected if there are any changes in universities' revenue, as suggested by University Scotland. In Scotland, we have some of the oldest universities in the world in St Andrews, Glasgow, Aberdeen and Edinburgh, but we also have the world's oldest educational trade union in the Educational Institute for Scotland. The EIS and the written evidence in the Higher Education Governance Bill states the bill would lead to HEIs remaining as autonomous bodies that are only accountable to themselves. University Scotland has claimed that the bill could lead to the reclassifications of HEIs as public bodies, leading to the potential loss of charitable status and fewer philanthropic bequests. The EIS does not believe that the bill brings increased control to the government that would lead to reclassification. They were also of the view that University Scotland's claims are simply supporting the personal interests of principals, some of whom may not welcome the additional scrutiny brought about by the bill. The National Union of Students, in their evidence to the committee, stated, "While we fully recognise the need of any further regulation to fully respect the autonomy of Scotland's HEIs, we do not believe the proposals set forward in the current bill alter that autonomy in a notable way. The proposed changes would not require institutions to implement any substantive policy changes. Rather, they address the process through which decisions on substantive issues are taken. We fully endorse the notion of responsible autonomy for our institutions. Where we have concerns is about the weight lent to both aspects of that, and are of the view that there has not been enough responsibility in return for the significant sums of public funding our institutions rightly receive." The SPICE briefing on main sources of funding provided to Scottish higher education institutes in 2013-14 identified total income in the sector to be £3.2 billion, with £2 billion coming from public sector grants and fees from across the EU, including £1 billion from the Scottish Funding Council. On ONS reclassification, the NUS concluded, "We would reject the assertion made by some in the sector that the bill poses such a threat to institutional autonomy that it places the charitable status of institutions at risk and raises the concerns of ONS reclassification. No thanks." The Office of Scottish Charity Regulator raised no concerns about the bill's provisions as set out in the original consultation, and I quote, "In our view, they would not affect the constitutions of higher education institutions in ways that would give ministers the power to direct or control these institutions' activities." They also raised no concerns in the response to the call for evidence issued by the Education and Culture Committee about the bill's provision. The Scottish Trade Union Council evidence was clear in why this bill is being introduced. This bill is not about government controlling universities, it is about good governance. Good governance procedures mean that the sector will function better and as a result spend money, public money better. In this way, the autonomy of the sector would be secured in the longer term by ensuring that institutions are better able to govern themselves and can show transparent and well-advanced evidence decisions around how they spend public funds. Better governance structures will also help the university meet the educational needs of students and better support the economic development of Scotland. As I said in my opening remarks, the quarter of a million staff and students are the university sector, and their views are at least as of equal importance as those of the university courts. The University and College Union is the largest trade union in the post-16 education sector, representing 120,000 academic and related staff across the UK, and is the largest union in the higher education sector in Scotland. Their view is,
We do not wish to see any increased influence by ministers in the running of universities and do not believe that the proposals outlined in the bill would do so. The proposals do allow ministers to ensure that the sector has improved and provides for more robust governance procedures. Given that the sector currently receives over £1 billion annually, we believe that politicians and Parliament are entitled to be assured that the sector is robustly governed. The proposals do not give powers to ministers to involve themselves in the day-to-day running of institutions or in setting targets beyond the current ministerial letter of guidance to the Funding Council. Presiding Officer, the Finance Committee reports on the bill contained a suggestion that ONS reclassification and charitable status was, and I quote, a smokescreen to avoid greater accountability in the sector. Having listened to the evidence of staff and students, I tend to agree.
Many thanks. I now call John Pentland to be followed by Chick Prodi.
Presiding Officer, the consequences of the ONS reclassification are very serious, and while I support making universities more democratic, I wouldn't want it to jeopardise their finances.
Mr Pentland, could you turn your microphone round slightly? Thank you.
I also don't want to see the democratic structures that are already exist in some institutions in any way diminished by a one-size-fits-all approach. The proposed changes have managed to line up an impressive array of opponents, not least the rectors past and present, who are, of course, already elected by students, or in the case of Edinburgh, staff and students at their representative and the chair of the university court. The rectors with reservations include a former Prime Minister, a former presiding officer, a current MEP, the author of the West Lothian Question, the author of Monroe Baggin Without a Beard, and the legendary Archie MacPherson, and several more. And we even have Edward Snowden tweeting from Russia about the dangers to the autonomy of universities, although it must be admitted that he's not a great advert for the importance of rectors as active participants in the university governance. So the question is, are these fears well-founded? In response to the rectors, a Scottish Government spokesperson said that universities are autonomous bodies and the ministers seek no control. Apparently, they just want more transparent and inclusive governance. The same spokesperson assured us that the Scottish Government has analysed risks associated with the potential reclassification of Scottish higher education institutions by ONS. We are confident that the provisions in this bill do not advance risk and are compliant with the indicators of government control that ONS use. Yep.
Minister.
Thank the member for giving way. And I am pleased to hear, I think, that the Labour benches share our concern to make university governance more representative of the communities that they seek to govern. What I would ask him, if he can clarify for me, is what is it that Labour wants to put into this bill to achieve those ends? What is it they want to put in that they feel would not fall foul of the objections that the Conservatives are making on ONS and other matters? Because Labour have not yet given us any indication what it is they would prefer to see in the bill other than what's there.
John Pentland.
Well, I think some reassurance could have been given if the government had kind of replied more spontaneously to some of the serious questions that have been raised by the University of Scotland. And I think also what we need is for you to put up the advice and evidence that is required to take away all these concerns. Those references to risk don't sound very reassuring to me, not least because the Scottish Government does not have a particularly good record of being right with such matters, even when, or perhaps especially when, they are supremely confident of being correct. And they, as we have heard before, just ask the police and fire services about their VAT bills. And sometimes it's even unclear whether they have proper legal advice. So while, you know, we may accept that the Scottish Government doesn't intend to inflict a huge financial penalty on higher education, and we might even accept that the Scottish Government genuinely believes that this bill will not compromise autonomy, would we be wise to take its word, particularly without external legal and technical advice and a full publication of all the analyses conducted to date in this manner? Of course not. Particularly when others have sought and published legal advice, including University of Scotland, who were told by Anderson Strathairn that, taken together with other existing government controls, the provisions in this bill would take higher education institutions into borderline territory in terms of their current ONS classification. Now, I don't necessarily think that it is the final word in legal terms, partly because rarely is there a final word in legal terms, but at least they have set out their reasons and published them. So the Scottish Government should stop saying it knows best when we know that too often it doesn't. We need a proper analysis of those risks so that we can decide whether they are acceptable rather than simply be told that they are. And the Scottish Government should make a formal commitment to remove all clauses from the bill that could increase the risk of ONS reclassification and to protect the role of the rector at those universities with such a tradition. Presiding officer, things are hard enough for higher education institutions and students without inflicting further financial disaster on them. For students, there would be added pressure. Information released this week by the Students Awards Agency for Scotland shows grants and bursary levels for Scotland's students down again, down by £40 million since the SNP took office in 2007. Fewer students getting less support from bursaries. Those from the poorer households who already struggle most would inevitably find it harder to undertake higher education courses. Meanwhile, student debt has soared as thousands who have the qualifications and the ability but not the finance are forced to borrow more to fund their studies. The Scottish Government says, trust us. Well, I'm quite sure everybody will remember the manifesto pledge to write off student debt.
Thank you. I now call Chick Brodie to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I declare an interest in that I used to be a lay member of St Andrews University Court. There are many things that borders on the unbelievable, and they occur from time to time in this chamber. But this motion stretches credulity just a bit too far. After all, the committee is still in the process of considering inputs to the bill. Yet here we have today a Conservative motion, and I don't lay this at the doors of Mrs Scanlon and Ms Smith, each of whom have behaved impeccably in their understandably robust questioning of witnesses at committee, but rather it would appear at the door of the opportunistic Conservative Central Office. Well, I've got news for you. We will complete the report and discuss it meaningfully, and then we can perhaps, with that evidence, have a substantive discussion. Here we have a motion with an alleged evidence riddled with ifs, with mights, with coulds, which all shows a propensity for rushing to judgment, which I thought was even below the capabilities by which that office might even be judged. Presiding Officer, we accept that Scotland's universities have a long-standing reputation for academic excellence and international success, at least for some, and it is a result of ability. But as the famous engineer and inventor Charles Kettering once said, if you've always done it that way, then it's probably wrong. The universities, like their other institutions, have to stay ahead of the game. Change is a constant, and in our universities, as elsewhere, there are limitless opportunities, and where there are open minds, there is always a frontier. Presiding Officer, the motion refers to Scotland's economic priorities and the need to develop there, to develop the university's research and capital assets in a way that allows them to make maximum use of the opportunities in knowledge exchange. Well, after a detailed questioning of university representatives at committee about their international involvement, about their equity participation in the many great products and services that they and their other universities produce. After that, the eventual answer was that they hadn't developed that thinking and would take it away for review. No change there then. Here, one of the great engines of our future economy, our universities and their R&D capabilities, and heavily publicly funded, are going away to think about that process and how they might generate more funding via that route for their universities. That and the further democratisation of the university courts is how we strengthen, not undermine, the university system in Scotland. Now, not everything is perfect in the bill, but let me now, Presiding Officer, turn to the contentious issue of possible reclassification of the university from a charitable to a public sector class. Well, the motion says it, does it not? It says, if, there's the magic word again, if the ONS reclassification was to occur, the higher education system would lose significant sums of money. It also bases this premise on evidence. On what evidence? On evidence placed on record by University of Scotland, based on a report which they had produced. Ms Smith, in her questioning, I don't have much time. Ms Smith, in her questioning of witnesses on the 6th of October, alluded to the proposed, not the evidenced, the proposed ONS classification. It's on page 19 of the official report of the 6th of October. The ONS classification, and accepted, she accepted the OSCR ruling that the public body's proposal would probably have no effect on the university's charitable status. And that was confirmed in an answer by Stephen White of the Scottish Government. The internal analysis by the government concluded that the bill's provision complied with control indicators of ESA 10. And on that subject, Presiding Officer, advice received by me from SPICE indicates that on the 10th and 17th of September said, and let me quote that advice, it said, the new European accounting guidance means that some projects that were formerly classified as private sector would now be classified as public sector. This, of course, potentially affects not a revenue issue, but capital projects financed through the NPD model. Three out of the four haven't even been looked at yet. There are another eight to come along. However, the ONS does have work plans for HEIs, for universities, that are being looked at. And specifically, as the Anderson and Strathairn report said, that the basis of that particular assessment is to review a change in policy on significant increases. Significant increases in tuition fee maxima that can be charged by universities in England and Wales. There is no specific reference in the work plans for Scottish HEIs to be assessed. So I would ask Liz Smith to avoid and erase the ifs, the mites, the coulds from her proposition, much of it unhappily reflected in the Anderson and Strathairn report. Let the committee and the Parliament pursue and finalise the questions that have been raised on all sides, and I mean from all sides, so that the committee's report can then be published. And in general, the world hates change, yet it is the only signpost to progress. So let's agree on that. Let's discuss it on production of the report and implement that change once we have followed the process and discussed what is presented to us as that report in detail.
Thank you. I now call Malcolm Chisholm, to be followed by Mary Scanlon.
The officer, I welcome the principles of the bill aiming to make the higher education system more modern, inclusive and accountable. And I believe that it's right to rebalance the power of university governing bodies to increase transparency and accountability and have more involvement of staff and students. And to that extent, I agree with the Scottish Government, and if they can preserve the position of rector, I, as a graduate of Edinburgh University, will be even more pleased. But where I agree with the Conservatives in their motion, that I have grave concerns around the financial implication, particularly of sections 8, 13 and 20. And of course, we know it's a vast range of external bodies who have expressed those concerns, such as, for example, the Royal Society of Edinburgh, whom I always respect. And the fact of the matter is that those sections of the bill were not in the original review of higher education governance. Their removal would not modify the central intent of the bill. So why do we need these undefined powers for undefined purposes? Why is the Scottish Government determined to take this risk when it would not actually take out the central thrust of the bill. And of course, look what we have to put at risk. All members are united today in celebrating the fact that we had five Scottish universities in the top 200 for the Times Higher Education World Rankings, three, in fact, in the top 100. And innovation and improvement are central to retaining those high standards, and they are dependent on financial security. So why do we is the government determined to take a risk with it? And I will explain why I think that is a serious risk, because the potential for ONS reclassification does put the financial security at risk. Now, loads of evidence we can summarise. A lot of it has been mentioned. The Committee of Scottish Chairs highlighted in their evidence to the Finance Committee various purposes. And let's not have the red herring of charitable status. ONS reclassification is something different. And they said, the Committee of Chairs, it would prevent universities from retaining their annual operating surpluses. It would place severe restraint on their ability to borrow funds. It would reduce their ability to enter into commercial partnerships and would threaten their philanthropic support. And again, Professor Muscatelli, whom we all respect, his evidence to the Finance Committee has been described by more than one person. He described his £775 million investment programme, finance from operating surpluses and £145 million in cash reserves, and he said he just could not use those if reclassification takes place. The Carnegie Trust made the same point about its grant giving to Scottish universities. So all these reputable individuals and bodies cannot just be discounted. They cannot just be accused of scaremongering or of having ulterior purposes. So I think it is incumbent on the Scottish Government to take this very seriously. Of course, it's actually worse for those universities that are less dependent on public funding. For example, Heriot Watt is only 49% dependent on public funding, probably more at risk, for example, than the University of the Highlands and Islands, which is, has 90% from public funding. But even Gary Coote, of course, chair of that university, gave very clear examples at the Finance Committee of the way in which the finances of his university would be affected by ONS reclassification. Now, of course, the government will say, well, that's not going to happen. But I think the essence here is, and we need to look at the Treasury guidance on the European System of Accounts 2010, the essence here, I think, is, and Treasury guidance says this, they will look at all controls, major and minor. And the key thing is cumulative effect. Of course, there is already an element of public control of universities. But the point is that the bill will increase it significantly, and that's what the risks come from. Treasury guidance also says on its interpretation of European System of Accounts that the power to change a constitution of a body is an indicator of ministerial control. So it's all there in black and white if the government is willing to read it. So how can their motion today say there is no increased risk? How can they say that emphatically? And they can't just sweep aside reputable law firms such as Anderson Tristern, who say it will heighten the risk of reclassification. And to quote in more detail, they say the provision in the bill would take HEIs into borderline territory in terms of their current ONS classification. So what legal advice did the Scottish Government take on the bill's potential to impact on ONS classification? We haven't heard. I know they won't reveal legal advice, but they could at least allude to it in some way and perhaps also tell us what discussions they've had with the ONS concerning this matter, because I think they certainly have the right to enter in those into those discussions. Even if the ONS or the Treasury wouldn't give any definitive view, they would at least be able to give some indication of what matters might be relevant. So I really think this is a very serious issue for universities in Scotland, and the government can't just put forward a motion that says, we say there's no risk, what are you all bleating about? This is unacceptable, and it's going to get worse. We're at the early stages of this bill, and we've had all these problems and issues raised at stage one, and really the government has to respond in a more constructive fashion. I agree with their wish to improve transparency and accountability in decision making. But we need to balance that most fundamentally with the need to maintain funds, but also to respect autonomy, which I and I hope the government fully support. So the simple solution, it won't satisfy the Conservatives, but the simple solution which would unite today the Conservatives, Liberal Democrats and Labour is remove those three sections from the bill.
Many thanks. I now call Mary Scanlon, to be followed by Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just say that I was very pleased when Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary, said, and I quote, "Where there is scope to alleviate concerns, we will listen," because I do think that this has been a constructive debate. It's been a very impressive debate from all sides, and I do hope that she will listen to what's being said today. I think we should all rightly be proud of our universities and their performance in the recent Times Higher Education World Rankings. And the Cabinet Secretary, in fact, said, "We really do punch above our weight, and thanks are due to our hard-working staff and students that have made this possible." We all agree with that. And yet, in thanking these staff and students, there now appears to be a proposal to burden them with punitive, unnecessary and counterproductive legislation, which they do not want. And if the government cannot speak highly enough of the success of Scotland's university, why, therefore, does it want to meddle in the autonomy and the governance? And as a member of the Education Committee, I have to say, I sat alongside Jocelyn Bell from the RSE and David Ross, and world-leading academics sat round that table. And I find it quite incredible that our best in the world, global academics, have misunderstood the government's intentions in this bill. But I'm sure that they will all be very, very grateful for a tutorial in future-proofing from the government, because they're obviously not quite up to understanding the legislation that comes out of this Parliament. But University Scotland are so concerned by the risk of ONS reclassification, they did commission their own legal advice from Anderson Strathairn. Now, much has been said today, but I'll take some quotes from it. "Heightens the risk of higher education institutions being reclassified by the ONS as being within the central government category. Considers that the bill brings itchy eyes closer to reclassification by ONS into the public sector. This borderline territory is an uncomfortable place for higher education institutions, because the major ramifications that would follow any ONS reclassifications of higher education institutions to the public sector." Anderson Strathairn, legal advice. And if there is legal advice, external advice, any advice to the contrary from the government, let's hear it. Yeah. Maybe Anderson Strathairn have misunderstood future-proofing as well. Maybe they're needing a wee tutorial as well. But I think it's important that if we've got one set of legal advice, if there's other legal advice, any advice, I'm up for listening to that. But, Presiding Officer, the governing bodies of Scotland's universities are very diverse. Diverse histories, traditions and goals. St Andrews, Aberdeen, Glasgow, founded in the 15th century, Edinburgh, Dundee, Stirling, Strathclyde, Heriot Watt, all established under a royal charter. And funnily enough, they've all managed to rub along pretty well. They're world leaders, and they've managed for succeeded and thrived for 600 years, and they've managed all of that without the government interfering. It's funny that now that they're global leaders, we need the government to tell them how to run their business. But Dame Jocelyn Bell Burnell of the Royal Society and Professor Tim O'Shea, they have also expressed concerns from their peers abroad and elsewhere in the UK. And they are already asking difficult questions as to why the Scottish government is interfering in the running of our world-leading universities. And I quote Dame Jocelyn, "When I am abroad, I find people saying to me, what's happening to Scottish universities? What's the government there doing? The implication is that there is interference. There is also a not quite articulated implication that there is a suppression of critical thought. That is not the word you want to get abroad. It will be devastating for the SNP and for the Scottish universities, but it's already out there and growing," end quote. Yep. We simply will not be able to attract the brightest and the best staff and students to Scottish universities if this is being whispered both at home and overseas. Presiding officer, universities like this chamber, the most valuable currency is their reputation, and I hope that these reputations will be irreparably damaged if this bill goes through. Whatever the final terms of the bill, the government is already giving the perception that it is prepared to damage Scottish universities, let alone its relationship, for little or no gain. Just 2 points before I finish. I'm running out of time. I think that what we haven't been looking at today is the current review, and I think a huge amount of progress that we all want to see has been achieved through that review. It's up next year. There is already a commitment to have 40% of both genders on government bodies, and in the last year, 42% of those appointed have been women. I welcome that. There's more to do, but that's being done through the voluntary code. I'll leave it there, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Dennis Robertson to be followed by Hans Alamalik.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, for me, this is a strange debate to be having in the chamber this afternoon to some extent, because no, I'm not a member of the Education Committee. I'm not a member of the Finance Committee. But my understanding is that the Education Committee have taken, what, one evidence session on this? And, you know, we're far from having a report from the committee that we can bring to stage one. Now, my understanding is that, you know, and I believe I was listening to the Cabinet Secretary, and I think she was giving this chamber reassurance that, yes, if there are parts within the bill that we need to look at, that she was listening. She said that, yeah, we'll try and give those reassurances to try and allay the fears that seem to be coming through. Now, quite often I'm amused sometimes with Mary Scanlon's remarks in this chamber, but for 1 minute there I thought I was visiting Dad's Army, because it sounded as if we're doomed, Presiding Officer. We're doomed. We've gone back to the 18th, 19th century. Look, we're in the 21st century. It is time to reform. And it's funny, we were listening to a lot of the comments this afternoon, and a lot of people were saying quotes from University of Scotland. Well, I didn't hear that many quotes from NUS. And it's funny, because, you know, even with the Ferdinand von Pranczycki's report, you're actually thinking, wait a minute, he was saying the universities are autonomous. Quite rightly so, they are. But we are looking for some degree of reform. And I was delighted to hear Malcolm Chisholm. Malcolm Chisholm in his opening remarks, and I probably agreed with just about everything Malcolm Chisholm said, apart from maybe the last couple of minutes, when he started, you know, maybe questioning, and it's quite right to question. But I think, you know, again, I heard what the Cabinet Secretary said in her opening remarks. But if Labour are agreeing with the principles of this bill, and only their only concern is about the reclassification with the Unionists, listen to what the Cabinet Secretary's assurances are coming forward. Let's have our stage one debate in this chamber. Let's have amendments being brought forward. Are we not a bit premature, Presiding Officer, in this debate this afternoon? Now, I've heard from others, you know, welcoming the fact that they are graduates from various universities. I'm a graduate of none. But perhaps I can listen, and perhaps I do listen. And I think we are in a situation where our rectors and our principals and our students and our staff are saying, yes, it is time for change. Yes, we will embrace it. Yes, we should be more democratic. Yes, we should be more transparent. What's wrong with that? I don't see anything wrong with that. Not unless some of the establishments want to remain and to try and have this sort of degree of elitism and actually keep certain people away from actually being on the boards or courts or whatever. I mean, Presiding Officer, what is wrong with being transparent and democratic? I would have thought that was something that most of us in this chamber would actually welcome. But it would appear that that's not the case. We're actually throwing up a situation that the ONS may reclassify. We don't know if that indeed would be right or not. But what I would say is the government, and I believe what the Cabinet Secretary has said, is, look, we would not use these powers. We have no intention of using these powers. And perhaps there is a way to find some consensus this afternoon to ensure that maybe those powers don't come forward. I don't know, Presiding Officer. And the reason I don't know is because this Education Committee have had one evidence session only one. So why this afternoon are we in a situation in this chamber of debating something that hasn't gone through the committee stages yet? And we have got a report that we can actually look at and look at all the evidence that's come from that evidence base. We've had submissions, we had briefs, yes, and that has enabled us to have this debate in the chamber this afternoon. But, presiding officer, I look forward to the stage one debate in this chamber, where we would have had more evidence sessions going through committee, where we would have had greater scrutiny, where the Cabinet Secretary and the Government would perhaps have gone back to the committee and maybe made some degree of reassurances that hopefully they are listening to and hopefully they can actually accept. Presiding officer, I have nothing else to say. Thank you.
Well said.
Thank you. I now call Hans Alamalik to be followed by Stuart Maxwell, and we have a little bit of time in hand now for interventions.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and good afternoon to you. First of all, I want to also declare that I've spent some time at Strathclyde University's court myself, like Annabel Gould. And I'm pleased to speak today on the topic of Scottish universities. We can all agree that Scottish universities make a major contribution to our economy, environment and society. There are some issues regarding governance that need to be clarified by legislation, and I have been contacted by a significant number of constituents who either study or work in Glasgow's thriving universities. One constituent expressed their view very well, stating that, and I quote, "I have become increasingly concerned at the lack of independence of my university's Senate and court bodies, both of which appear to be very compliant in the face of questionable strategy decisions," unquote. And I would agree with some of those sentiments, if not all. I wholeheartedly support the National Union of Students Scotland, the UNS Scotland, and the University and College Union, the UCU, in their calls for elected chairs in a bid to increase the transparency and accountability of decision-making of governing bodies. On the other hand, there are sectors of the Higher Education Governance Scotland Bill. I have to question the motivation for the reform, as I do not understand the problems they are seeking to fix. Some go as far as to say that they're perhaps trying to gag universities. There may be some element of truth in that. That time will tell. The bill significantly raises the risk of reclassification of universities by the Office of National Statistics, ONS, from non-profit institutions servicing households to central government bodies. These are additional risks to the HE institutions. Charitable status is one of the issues that come to light immediately. Therefore, this legislation, if we get it wrong, could severely financially damage to our education institutions and have been furthermore decisions to be made to ensure that that does not happen in these circumstances. The Conservative Party's motion mentions universities as autonomous and independent institutions, and that is a fact that this is the case. There has been a lot of discussion about the autonomy of university government bodies, but little has been stated about their diversity. Research conducted by the UNS, Scotland in 2014 highlighted that despite recommendations made through the HE Code of Good Governance, university courts are still dominated by men. Governing bodies also suffer from the lack of diversity in terms of wider protection, characteristics such as low numbers of ethnic minority representation, which I feel is a failure to properly reflect the diverse community and our population in Scotland today. Despite the recommendations from the Code of Good Practice, Good Governance, that institutions should monitor and report on diversity of their governing bodies, there is still no data currently held. If this is not being produced on a voluntary basis, perhaps the Parliament should consider making this a statutory requirement to ensure that that does happen. I think it's absolutely vital that, one, we protect our institutions who do so much for us in Scotland, not only in terms of its economy, its environment and the contribution to society, but also the well-being of our future education. We've had education, historically we've had education institutions in Scotland who've managed very well without this type of interference. I genuinely don't understand why we need to risk fixing something that's not broken. Therefore, I suggest to the government that they really need to think very seriously about tampering with this situation, and also in terms of reflecting the community out there in terms of their board representation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I now call Stuart Maxwell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to discuss a number of important issues that have arisen concerning the bill. But before I get into that, I have to say that I thought the speech by Dennis Robertson really hit the nail on the head here. And you know, while of course the Conservatives are entirely free to bring forward any subject they wish to debate in the chamber, I think it does show some disrespect to the parliamentary system and the committee. That the fact is, the committee has not taken the evidence, has not discussed the matter, has not written a report,
and
we're not at the stage one process yet. So I think it is a bit premature, as other members have said, and I think Dennis Robertson was quite correct in his remarks. Presiding Officer, Scotland greatly values the role that education plays in our society, and we're all quite rightly proud of the success of our universities. Now, I'm certain that the whole chamber is united in wanting to see our higher education institutions rated amongst the world's best. Having 5 universities in the world's top 200 is a remarkable achievement, and it seems to me that taking steps to modernise our universities so that they continue to be the world's leading universities is a worthwhile ambition. The Higher Education Governance Bill has certainly received a lot of attention. The Education and Culture Committee's call for evidence generated a wide variety of comment and input from across the sector, with around 300 written submissions received from a diverse range of contributors. The committee undertook an oral evidence session earlier this month, involving a number of expert stakeholders and government officials. And of course, we also look forward to welcoming the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning when she comes before committee in a couple of weeks' time to give further evidence on the bill. Now, during that evidence session on the 6th of October, I asked officials about the concerns expressed by the Scottish Council of Jewish Communities around widening the statutory definition of academic freedom. The response was to say that they had not yet had the chance to review the evidence submitted by SCOJEC due to the number of submissions received. I would be grateful to ask if the Minister, in his summing up, could address that issue. I hope that after a number of weeks, there will be a response forthcoming. Presiding Officer, there has certainly been a degree of scepticism from certain sections of the higher education sector about the bill. But I welcome assurances from the Cabinet Secretary that she is working hard to address concerns and is in regular dialogue with key stakeholders on these issues. The Cabinet Secretary has also offered reassurances that all evidence submitted will be looked at seriously and constructive suggestions will be listened to. It's worth remembering that the bill is still in its early stages. Yes, a number of details about the proposals still need to be addressed, but I think the overall objectives of the bill are indeed extremely commendable. Now, like many in the Chamber, I have been contacted by a number of constituents about the Higher Education Governance Bill. I understand that some of the universities have indeed urged their alumni to write to MSPs raising concerns about the proposals. I've seen some of these letters. It appears that there has been a considerable amount of misinformation disseminated in the press and elsewhere, resulting in misconceptions about parts of the bill. That's not to say that correspondence from constituents has only been negative. Indeed, just last night, I received an email from an academic, one of my constituents, who works at one of our universities, who wrote to me urging me to strongly support the proposals contained in the bill. They said, and I want to quote, "I hope that you will be able to offer your support for this bill, which I believe offers a rare opportunity to make positive, far-sighted reforms, which will be of lasting benefit not only to Scottish universities and those who work and study in them, but also to the nation itself." There are individuals There are groups, there are organisations, there are representative bodies right across the sector who are fully behind the efforts of the government to modernise and bring transparency and openness to the governance of our university sector. At the last session of FMQs, the First Minister was clear that the Higher Education Governance Bill is not about the government taking control of universities. If that was the case, I would be opposing it. Members of this committee, of our committee, would be opposing it. Members on these benches would be opposing it, because that is not what this government is about. It is not about taking control of the university sector, and it is frankly nonsensical to say so. Rather, it is about delivering a modern system of governance that meets the highest standards of transparency and inclusiveness. It's about placing the students and staff of higher education institutions at the very heart of decision-making in our universities.
Neil Findlay.
Did Mr Maxwell seriously expect us to believe that people from his side would be opposing this bill if the government put it forward? That would be a first, wouldn't it?
Stuart Maxwell.
Is Mr Findlay seriously suggesting that members in this chamber don't actually think for themselves? Because I think that's insulting. I think that's insulting.
And
it may be the way that the Labour Party works. It may be the way that the Labour Party works. I have no idea, because frankly,
Audrey,
we have no
please.
Idea what the Labour Party does from one day to the next. But the fact remains that there are members in all parts of this chamber who would not accept any government interfering to take control of our higher education institutions. And that applies equally to members on these benches as in other benches. And frankly, it's insulting to suggest otherwise. Now, the First Minister was also very clear that the bill does not represent a threat to the charitable status of universities in Scotland. The Office of the Scottish Charity Regulator responded to the Education and Culture Committee's call for evidence and did not raise any concerns about the bill's provisions in that regard. This is just one example of an area of the proposed legislation that has been misinterpreted, to be kind about it. There had also been concerns voiced about the potential risk of the proposals to the role of rector at the ancient universities. On the contrary, as we've already heard, that is not going to happen. The bill does not seek to abolish the position of rector, but to extend the elected chair model to the governing bodies of every university across the country. The Scottish Government has repeatedly said that the proposals for new elected chairs are not intended to lead to the abolition of rectors. Indeed, when the committee wrote to the Cabinet Secretary ahead of its stage one scrutiny of the bill, the Cabinet Secretary replied, confirming that the Scottish Government would seek to minimise and even remove any features that could negatively affect the role of rector. Now, I had intended, Presiding Officer, to discuss the issue of ONS reclassification, but others have, I think, have already covered this issue in detail. Having listened carefully to the arguments, my view is that there is really no serious risk to the financial position of Scotland's HEIs, and it is indeed a smokescreen or a scare story. There's undoubtedly been a degree of scaremongering about these proposals, and it's unfortunate that this has distracted from what the bill sets out to achieve. Some have even questioned why the Scottish Government is bothering to even take such legislation forward. While I accept that there has been some progress since the introduction of the Code of Good HE Governance following the von Brunzinski review, that doesn't mean that there isn't still substantial room for improvement.
If you could draw to a close, I would be grateful.
Presiding Officer, in conclusion, our universities are a real success story, but I don't accept that moves to improve their governance will put the success of our universities at risk. Although the HE Governance Bill is still at an early stage, it's important to remember that it's underpinned by the comprehensive research and recommendations put forward by Professor von Brunzinski. If universities don't exist to serve their students, their staff, their communities, then who do they exist to serve? I've yet to hear a convincing argument for what is wrong with giving staff and students a greater say in how their universities are governed. It's only right that every voice on campus is given the opportunity to be heard equally.
Thank you very much. We now turn to the closing speeches, and I call on Mark Griffin. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I had said at the Education and Culture Committee at the start of the month that I supported the general principles of the Higher Education Governance Bill. I support the inclusion of trade union reps, of student reps on governing bodies. I support that democratisation of higher education institute governing bodies. And that support has been echoed by all of my Labour colleagues in the debate today. And I think it's unfair to question our support for those principles because of the concerns that we have raised around ONS classification. Now, similarly, at committee, I had also said that the issue around ONS reclassification was quickly becoming a key issue for the Scottish Government, and understandably, given the potential impact the sector, given the real fears in the university sector around the financial implication of reclassification, I think it's only right that we debate the issue in the chamber today. Now, George Adam and others have talked about that issue detracting from the positive measures in the bill, and I would agree with Mr Adam, which is why I think the government should support the motion and amendment today and make that commitment to remove those sections which increase the threat of reclassification. Jennifer Craw of Robert Gordon University said at committee, ONS reclassification is a real risk to the sector when it comes to future investment and success. As governing bodies, we absolutely have to take financial accountability into account. Our principals are accounting officers in relation to the Scottish Funding Council, and as chairs and boards, we are accountable for the financial sustainability of the organisations as a whole. The ONS reclassification of colleges as public bodies has had a severe impact on the further education sector, and it is not a risk that we can afford to take with the HE sector. We're too successful, we're too important to the Scottish economy to put the sector at risk. I think that all parties in the motion, the amendments and the contributions today in the chamber recognise the importance of the higher education sector to Scotland's economy and our international standing, and so we should be listening to their views and responding to their concerns. In the government amendment, it states that it would always seek to avoid any risk of the reclassification of higher education institutes as public sector bodies by the ONS, and further notes that the bill's provision do not increase that risk. But, Presiding Officer, that directly contradicts the evidence given to both the Finance and Education and Culture Committees by the Scottish Government officials. Scottish Government officials stated that we deem reclassification to be a low risk. Now, granted that they have stated that they believe it to be a low risk, but that is a risk all the same. Similar to Liam MacArthur and Malcolm Chisholm, I can't understand how a Parliament can support an amendment in the name of the Cabinet Secretary which directly contradicts the evidence given to parliamentary committees by the Cabinet Secretary's own officials. Yep, certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
I just wondered if the member was aware of the correspondence that I'd sent to the Finance Committee that goes through in detail the ESA 10 guidance, which is essentially looking at the indicators of government control and how we assess that risk cumulatively, as spoken about by Mr Chisholm, and how we look to each indicator separately, and that we have shared our assessment and why we have reached the conclusion that this bill does not increase the risk of ONS reclassification.
Mark Griffin.
I did ask questions at committee of your officials around the assessment, and I'll come on to that in a minute. Now, as I've said, government officials do believe that there is a risk of reclassification, and I've stated that it is a serious, an extremely serious issue. Universities Scotland also believe that there is a risk of reclassification, but in their assessment have concluded that, far from being low risk, the risk of reclassification is amber to red risk. And I did ask Scottish Government officials about the risk assessment process, and they confirmed that the process they have followed, as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, would be the same one as University Scotland, that they've looked at exactly the same materials, that they've looked exactly at exactly the same indicators of control. Yet the concern that I have is that we have a radically different outcome. A government coming to the conclusion that there is a low risk, and others coming to the conclusion that the risk is much, much higher. Now, that's not me personally taking sides in a debate. That's simply flagging up a gulf in legal opinion. And when the consequences are so far-reaching, I think that's something that the government has to take seriously. Sorry, I'm pressed for time, Mr Mason. I think it's of utmost importance that, given the significance of the sector, the Scottish Government do seriously consider the course of action suggested in the motion and our amendment and seek urgent external legal and technical advice on the matter, and to publish in full all of that analysis. And I would welcome a further commitment by the Cabinet Secretary and, or the Minister in closing remarks of a commitment to today to remove all clauses from the bill that could increase the risk of ONS reclassification. I think if the Government is serious about that, they would follow that sensible and pragmatic course of action. Presiding Officer, there have been other issues and other pieces of legislation which we have debated in this chamber where the Government have believed their position to be correct in relation to legal EU legal advice, college reorganisation, around VAT exemption for the new National Police and Fire Services, but the Government have simply been wrong in their assertions and assumptions. I think the repercussions for getting it wrong here are too serious, and I would ask the Government to take a further look at that and to look at the course of action set out in the amendment today. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Dr. Alistair Allen. 8 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government certainly welcomes today's debate, and I've noted carefully all the contributions. Many of them were very considered indeed, and I think of the remarks of Liz Smith, Cara Hilton, Liam MacArthur, John Mason, Malcolm Chisholm, and many others. I think there were some contributions that were predictable. I think possibly some of my friends who are graduates will be surprised to learn from Ian Gray that tuition fees were abolished 14 years ago, but let's not rehash that debate. There were some contributions which, while thoughtful, I would have to disagree with. In an otherwise carefully considered contribution, I do feel nonetheless that Baroness Goldie talked about the governance of our universities as if they were merely corporations. I think they are a great deal more than that, and I think perhaps unwittingly she failed to fully realise that when she pursued the argument that university courts should be accountable primarily to themselves and not to a wider academic community. Some interesting I will give way.
Annabelle Goldie.
Very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary. I hope, Cabinet Secretary, I was at pains by my
reference. Ms Goldie, could you pull your microphone up, please? Thank you.
My apologies. Cabinet Secretary, I was at pains to refer to the SQA inquiry conducted by this very Parliament, which was into governance of a public body. So I would like to make clear I had no desire to conflate all this with corporate governance. I gave a public body example, which the committee refuted the very model the Cabinet Secretary wants to bring forward.
Minister?
Well, my point is, of course, about the wider responsibility to a community, and I stand by my remarks on that, notwithstanding what the member has said. I think there were other comments that were made today that were certainly important around issues around academic freedom, which, of course, this legislation seeks to enshrine. I have to differ with Hanzala Malik. I think he must be talking about a different university system if he thinks that it's subject to government gag at any time in this country. On the other side of that equation or the discussion around that, Mr Maxwell raised interesting questions. I'm very happy to meet his constituents. I suspect that some of the questions they may have, although I don't want to preempt that, may be around the part of the bill dealing with academic freedoms. And certainly, we want to be very clear that...
Dr Allen, if you turn away from the microphone, it's difficult for others to hear. Thank you.
Okay. I would certainly want to be very clear that academic freedom is not an excuse for inciting criminality or acts of racial or religious hatred, and the bill will make that very clear. I am happy to meet with his constituents, though, about the concerns that they have. Now, the Tories told us their view of the bill, and I will seek to respond to that in a minute. But before I do, though, I have to admit I am still, I'm afraid, little nearer understanding Labour's stance in principle on the bill itself. Now, Labour have said, and I welcome the fact that they said this throughout the debate, that they are supportive of the idea that university governance is reformed to allow a greater role for staff, for students and for unions. The problem with the Labour Party position today is that in joining us on that, they simultaneously also felt compelled to join with the Tories in their argument that pretty much anything that we have put in the bill and everything we have put in the bill is, at least in theory, a threat to the ONS classification of our universities. And I think it's difficult for Labour, I will give way in a minute, but I think it is difficult for Labour, and I've said this before already in this debate, I think it is difficult for Labour to pursue a credible position on this unless they can tell us what they would like to put into the bill. So I look forward to hearing that.
Ian Gray.
The Minister's position is patently absurd. We support elected chairs, we support greater transparency, we support trade union and student representation. The way in which that is to be achieved should appear in the bill so that it is then possible to remove from the bill those undefined powers for ministers which the minister and his colleague, the cabinet secretary, have spent the whole afternoon telling us they don't want to exercise anyway. I hope that is straightforward enough for the minister to understand.
Minister.
Well, I'm sure that for a moment or two, Mr. Gray could suspend his patronising tone long enough to appreciate that this side of the chamber appreciates these points completely, and also appreciates that there is a certain onus to come forward with ideas for bills that you attack in the chamber. But the Higher Education Governance Bill will, I believe, and as far as I can tell, Labour agrees with this point. It will be interesting to see how they vote on it. But as far as I can tell, Labour agree with this point that the Higher Education Governance Bill will improve the modernity, transparency and inclusivity of governance in our higher education institutions. The Scottish Government is investing over £1 billion in our higher education institutions this year, and we do that to advance learning and to foster inclusive economic growth. The autonomy of higher education institutions helps them to be forward-thinking and innovative, and on that much I think we are all agreed. So let me put this on the record again, as the Cabinet Secretary already has done. This Government is not interested in ministers having any role in the business of running universities or in interfering in what individuals universities appoint to any post. However, the idea that the rules under which universities operate are incapable of improvement is a council of despair and one that I reject. The implication that nothing can be done which would make the governing bodies of universities more reflective of the communities that they serve is also one that I reject. And the assertion implied in the motion that any attempt to make such an improvement is inimical to academic freedom is not one I feel is substantiated or has been borne out in this debate. This bill aims to strengthen governance in our institutions by empowering all staff and students to play a full part in guiding our academic institutions further into the 21st century. And to be clear again, we are not of the view that the content of this bill adds to any risk of reclassification of Scottish higher education institutions as public sector bodies by the ONS. I must come to a conclusion now. Reclassification is not an outcome that the Scottish Government would ever seek. I'd like to reiterate that as we begin to plan for stage two of the Bill's parliamentary consideration, we continue to examine all of the constructive ideas and suggestions put to us and the relevant committees of this Parliament by stakeholders. The Cabinet Secretary, for instance, has made very clear that she is willing to do that. And although at one point, for instance, in this debate, Section 20 was mentioned, I think it is possibly worth saying that this is a section that is pretty much standard to most, if not all, pieces of legislation. However, the Cabinet Secretary has already given an indication around our openness to thinking about Section 1, and I'm sure we'll have discussions on Section 8 and 13 at Stage 2. Presiding Officer, I want to conclude by emphasising the aim of this bill, which is to help to enhance the reputation of our institutions which are world class and which I believe this legislation will help into the future.
Many thanks. And I now call on Gavin Brown to wind up the debate. You have just over 10 minutes till 4:59, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Well, there was a rumour circulating at the start of the summer that
the Scottish Government had been blindsided by the ONS reclassification issue. Now, not all rumours proved to be true, Presiding Officer, so I was keen to hear the evidence given to both the Finance Committee and the Education Committee. But as every day has gone on since the rumours first circulated, it has become more and more apparent that the Government hasn't done anywhere near enough work on the ONS class reclassification issue. And given what could be at stake, that is simply unacceptable for the Government to behave in that fashion. Because ONS reclassification, in a moment, is not some kind of mythical beast, Presiding Officer. It is a real possibility. And this Government and this Parliament should be extremely cautious after the Aberdeen Western peripheral route. We have seen evidence in recent months of what the implications of reclassification can be, and we were told in advance of that that it was very unlikely, that we'd taken every precaution, that we were extremely safe and it wouldn't happen. And yet it did, Presiding Officer. There are other schools and hospitals up and down the country who could be reclassified next month and in December. So I think it is an absurd position to take from the Scottish Government that we didn't worry about anything. We've seen it happen, we've been burned already, and we should take absolutely every single precaution to make sure it doesn't happen again. Now, I would give way to Mr Mason.
John Mason.
Thank the member for giving way. Would you accept that the Scottish Government has developed considerable expertise and it is actually quite hard to find other organisations out there with more expertise?
Gavin Brown.
Presiding Officer, there's not been a huge amount of expertise evident in the chamber today from the SNP, but what I'd say to Mr Mason, because he did ask a perfectly reasonable question, who could possibly give the Scottish Government advice, was the tone of his questioning. Well, Presiding Officer, there are any number of large law firms in Edinburgh and beyond in Scotland. There are any number of financial institutions who could give them advice. And Mr Mason may be keen to know that even when the AWRP issue came up, the Scottish Government actually did, at least at times, do its best to try and make that safe. John Swinney gave evidence in this chamber where he said they had taken five separate bits of legal and technical advice from external sources to try and make sure they gave it the best chance. So it is inexplicable why this part of the Scottish Government hasn't taken a single piece of external advice. Nobody outside the Scottish Government has given any technical, any financial or any legal advice on an issue that could cost our universities £1 billion a year if we get it wrong. If we get it wrong. Okay, they could review it and decide that they remain as non-profit institutions serving households. But just as equally, they could not. They could decide that it must be public sector and we therefore lose £1 billion. That's why I think we have to be extremely cautious. Now, let me pick up on some of the issues that have been raised. Chick Brodie mentioned that it's not specifically on the ONS work plan in terms of the published calendar. Now, that is true, Presiding Officer. In terms of the published work plan, they have agreed to look at higher education institutions south of the border. But as we know, there is every possibility that they could look at Scottish institutions, particularly as legislation is going through. And there is a historical precedent. When colleges and sixth form colleges were first looked at, Scotland was not on the map. But we all know what happened in 2010. Scottish colleges were brought into that inquiry and they were reclassified, a position they have remained in ever since. So just because it's not specifically on the agenda today, I think there's every possibility it would come up. Let me deal with the confusion that a number of members, primarily I have to say in the SNP, have come up with today. They've tried to use a letter from Oscar as a crumb of comfort. Now, anyone who is using that is conflating two entirely separate issues. ONS reclassification is a separate issue from charitable status by Oscar. That Oscar letter is extremely helpful in terms of charitable status, because it is ultimately they who would decide. Yeah. So we can take some comfort from that. Although even in so doing, I would point out that they say they would look at how the regulations were actually used and they could in future reach a different view. But at this stage, they've reached a view. But that letter is of no value whatsoever when the ONS will take their decision on reclassification. So any member who thinks we can rely on that, I'm afraid, is severely misguided and has quite simply got it wrong. We heard, Presiding Officer, that this Scottish Government doesn't want extra powers. They don't want any of these extra powers, and they don't want ministerial control. And we heard the suggestion that some of the powers they're being given are just a simple tidying-up exercise or just future-proofing. That was the exact term used. We'll read out Section 8, just for the sake of the record, so that it can be clear the type of powers that are being given. Section 8 gives Scottish ministers the power to modify the governing body of all of our universities. Scottish ministers may, by regulations, modify the categories of membership of people who can be on governing bodies and the number of persons to be appointed under a particular category in that section. Presiding Officer, that is a pretty strong power. That is not just future-proofing or a tidying-up exercise, and that is something which is causing deep concern to universities across the land. Happy to give
Cabinet
way to
Secretary.
The Minister.
I appreciate Mr Brown giving way. And just for the record, perhaps to reiterate some of the debate this afternoon, for the record, I've already said that Section 1 will be replaced when we insert the plans with the model of electing chairs. As Dr Allen has already said, Sections 8 and 13 can indeed be looked at, as would be the norm as part of the parliamentary process, and Section 20 is indeed a fairly standard clause that is many pieces of legislation.
Gavin Brown.
Presiding Officer, 2 points. First one is, why on earth did they go into the bill in the first place? When the government had a full report and then had a full consultation on what ought to be in the bill, with 37 questions being asked specifically, why on earth was that not mentioned, that they were intending to put these powers in the bill? If the Minister can answer that, perhaps Ian Gray will be able to answer
Gray.
That question.
Well, I wanted to ask Mr Brown in addition whether he thinks it passing curious that if the Cabinet Secretary is saying she will make some of the changes which we've been asking for in the bill, why the Government amendment tonight tells us that the bill is in fact already perfect and has no problems.
Gavin Brown.
OK, it's becoming a little circular. I can't possibly answer why the Minister or indeed the SNB have taken that view. But to echo the comments of a couple of others, I'm genuinely perplexed by the government amendment here today, because they claim to be opening and listening, but they say in black and white, in clear terms, that they don't think the totality of the terms of this bill moves one iota the risk of ONS reclassification. Now, I don't know how any government can say it is risk-free and doesn't move it at all, particularly when they haven't taken any external legal, technical or financial advice. Presiding Officer, we have had legal advice. Universities took legal advice, and they took, I have to say, the extraordinary step, the particularly helpful step, but the extraordinary step of putting that legal advice in the public domain. They gave the full legal advice to the Finance Committee, to the Education Committee, which of course then went online, and anybody could have access to it. And the bit that I don't quite understand is, despite this legal advice being out there for all to see, despite the government having a fixed view on the situation, almost a month later, there has been no formal rebuttal from the Scottish Government to the legal advice given by Anderson Strathairn. And I find that remarkable, that they haven't even attempted to rebut the legal advice that was given. Why have they not taken their own legal advice? Why have they not attempted to address the issues raised? Because they conclude that it heightens the risk. They conclude that it takes us into borderline territory, which is an extremely uncomfortable place for our universities to be. And they say that an ONS assessment exercise should appear at the level of significant risk in their risk registers. Those are strong conclusions, Presiding Officer, and Anderson Strathairn lay out very clearly which documents ought to be looked at, ESA 2010, MGDD 2014, and Treasury guidance of 2013. Yet when the Scottish Government put their letter to the Finance Committee, they make no mention of two of those documents. They make no mention of the indicator of control that looks to changes of the constitutions of those universities, and they give scant regard to the indicators that they do mention, particularly government control via regulation, which is one of the main complaints of this bill, is simply skimmed over in the government's response. Presiding officer, we have been burned in Scotland by ONS reclassification in the past, so we should be ultra-cautious as we proceed. We should take every single bit of advice that we possibly can, and if there is any doubt whatsoever, those clauses must be removed from the bill. And it is incumbent on the Scottish Government to take that advice, to publish that advice, and to remove any doubt whatsoever, because the consequences of not doing so could be dramatic on our universities, and it could take many, many years to fix. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Brown. That concludes the debate on Scotland's universities. We now move to the next item of business, which is consideration of a business motion number 14620 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14620.
Moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 14620 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of three business motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions number 14617, 14618 and 14619, setting out timetables for various bills.
Moved on block.
I propose to ask a single question to these motions. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put. Therefore, I now put the question to the chamber, and that is that motion numbers 14617, 14618 and 14619 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motions are therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I'd ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14460 on approval of an SSI.
Moved.
The question on this motion will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. Can I remind members that in relation to debate on Scotland's universities, if the amendment in the name of Angela Constance is agreed, the amendment in the name of Ian Gray falls. The first question then is that amendment number 14596.2 in the name of Angela Constance, which seeks to amend motion number 14596 in the name of Liz Smith on Scotland's universities be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 14596.2 in the name of Angela Constance is as follows. Yes, 64. No, 54. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Ian Gray falls. The next question is that motion number 14596 in the name of Liz Smith on Scotland's universities be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast the vote now. The result of the vote on motion number 14596 in the name of Liz Smith as amended is as follows. Yes, 64. No, 54. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14460 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of an SSI be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members should leave the chamber, should do so quickly and quietly.